the keyboard, you've got the 11-inch iPad Pro. So the keyboard is kind of narrow. Is that pretty? That was my problem with keyboards that are fitted for the, an 11-inch iPad is, for me, they're all kind of tight,
The 11 inch
width-wise.
is fine for me. Where I do hit a breaking point is if I try to use a keyboard case on the iPad mini. That is impossible for me. But the 11 inch is comfortable enough, and I think I've worked on it enough that my fingers are able to work with it. So.
I use a Bluetooth keyboard with my iPad mini, but they're all not form fitted. They're all like 75% keyboard size, which is perfect for me. That's what I use on my desktop too these days, a 75% mechanical keyboard. In fact, I started to use, speaking of, I think it was Don who suggested it, I started using a mechanical keyboard with my iPad, and I love the thocky, clicky, clacky sound. Makes me happy. It's a happy place.
See, John, it has benefits for you, both making you happy and invoking terror in others. I think
Yes, it's
it's
all
a
this.
win-win situation.
And if you
Win-win.
want to show emotion on a mechanical keyboard while your students are listening, you just tap it really hard. And
One
play.
thing I also turned on the M4 iPad that is a weird setting when you really think about it, but it's the world we live in. It's the hold charge at 80% setting
Oh
that they now have on the iPhone 15 has it, but the M4 iPad has it as well.
yeah.
As we know about battery tech, I mean, that does keep your battery in a little bit nicer of shape.
Yeah.
And that's sort of on my mind because my iPad or my iPhone 13 Pro now is eligible for battery service because it's gone below the 80% mark. So I think in a week and a half, I'm going to take it to an Apple store and have them swap it out under AppleCare because you really have to notice when those things dip below 80% of their max battery capacity.
I got a Google Pixel tablet last summer when it was released, and it by default charges maximum 90% unless you say otherwise. So, by default is 90%. Actually, it's like 89% now. I don't know, it's because my battery's aging, but it's a
Even
great idea.
my Pixel 6, and I think it's when you're using the Pixel stand, will recognize prolonged sitting on the charging pad and will actually throttle, and it gives you a notification that it's throttling.
Yeah, and
Everybody seems to, it seems to be the way to do. I know I've had it with some specific, some Windows, some of the hardware vendors do the same thing, and provide it as a capability that they throttle at certain percentages, and 80 is a common one.
Yeah, I haven't, John, I'm glad you reminded me because I have not done that for my iPad Pro yet. And I will after this podcast. But my iPhones and my Android devices are all on adaptive charging, which is a little different from 80% because it adaptive means sometimes it'll go to 100. And but most time it'll be like sub 90 or sub 80. So I also do that my watch. I still have a Series 6, and after I switched to 80%, I seem to get better battery life. I don't get it. All right. And now, so the when so you can charge the iPad while it's on the keyboard, which none of my keyboards will do because I
Yes.
have to have separate cables.
Which also means you could, if you wanted to, you could leave the keyboard case at a desk or something like that, always on a charger, and just detach the iPad, take it with you, and then come back and slide it and magnetically reattach it. So you were talking about the lack of a dock case, such as what Google has for the Pixel tablet. You could do that with this just the same way. You always have it connected up to power if you wanted to have a semi-permanent setup.
How much is the 11-inch keyboard? I think slightly less than the 13-inch. It's kind of
I
expensive,
think it was
right?
249 or 299, something around there.
I should note, by the way, speaking of Apple, right after I ordered or pre-ordered my iPad Pro and Pencil Pro, I went to Costco, as I do, because I live a mile and a half away. And they said, oh, we'll have our iPad Pros and things on the, May 15th. So I could have just gone to Costco. And they have a trade-in kiosk. So you can trade in your Apple product, and you can get a Costco, you know, gift card, and you can apply that to your new iPad. So I might buy my new iPhone, my next iPhone from Costco, and save myself the anxiety of waiting for shipments. Because Apple doesn't tell you it's shipping until the day before. You know, they want to be mysterious. So, yeah, I don't like that. I want to know days in advance. Yes, it's, you know, gone here, it's gone here, it's gone here. That's how I feel happier. But I'm pretty happy. So how do you, and they're moving from, A-series iPad to M-series. That's a huge jump. I mean,
And I do notice a difference in speed, especially in loading web pages and a number of other things. You can tell that it is a faster device. And I'll know more over the next couple of months as I use it more. But I do think it was a worthwhile upgrade in that regard.
I went from an M2 to the M4, you know, even though it's my M2 is only, you know, a little over 2 years old, I think. Because I really wanted to play with the new Apple Pencil Pro, which I have a few things to say about that because I really haven't been able to. And B, I was really curious about the OLED screen. And I will say I've not done AB or ABCD because I now have several iPad Pros to kind of, you know, I haven't like sorted my iPad Pros and tried to see which ones, if it's really that much nicer, but maybe, you know, maybe in dealing with cognitive dissonance, the screen looks a lot better just looking at it without doing A/B testing or anything. It just seemed like, wow, you know, the dark colors, the saturation seems a little higher and the black dots are really, you know, really dark. So a lot of contrast, pretty happy with that. I have an oddity for that. So John, did you try Find My with your Apple Pencil Pro yet?
I have not. I enabled it, but I have not tried playing with it to see. So, I don't intentionally try to lose things regularly. So
that's the thing I was going to point out. You have to enable it. All my other Apple devices were just findable from the moment you activate them and you log in with your account information. But the Apple Pencil Pro, you actually have to go into the iPad it's being used with and turn it on, which I, you know, and then once you do, there's no audio or vibrating or anything. So, you know, if you lost it in a little hidey area, or if in your case, John, if one of your pets grabbed it and decided to hide it somewhere, you would still have a problem finding it. All right. Okay. Oh, the other thing I wanted to mention is that, so during the Apple event on May 7th, you know, Procreate, which is the app I use for my little daily doodles most of the time, was the featured vendor showing how the Apple Pencil Pro can, you know, do a barrel roll and all this kind of stuff and squeeze for the menu. Guess who hasn't updated their production app yet?
Gee, that just seems par for the course.
And none of the drawing apps I use, and I have like, I don't know, 8 or 9 that I've, you know, bought, or, you know, got or are free apps, but I bought a lot of apps for my daily doodle project and none of them support the new features in the Apple Pencil Pro. The only apps that do support it, I know it works because where it does work is in Apple Notes and Apple Freeform.
Okay.
And I think GoodNotes now has GoodNotes 6, I think now has support. But I have the free version of GoodNotes. I know what it is. I paid for GoodNotes 5 and they want me to pay for GoodNotes 6. And it's now a subscription. It's not a one-time thing. So I'm like, do I really need GoodNotes now that I'm retired? I don't know. I just need, you know, mediocre notes. I don't need them to be good. All right. So those are my... Now, Don, you found something that was announced that I missed completely in... Or was it Swen? Who put that in there?
It wasn't me. I didn't type anything in this one.
Oh, well, this would be me.
Oh, that was you, John. I thought it was Don.
So Apple, always around International Accessibility Day, or they announced some accessibility features in advance of WWDC. This is where Assistive Touch was announced a couple years ago. And they announced eye tracking. as a new accessibility feature coming in the next version of iOS. And I had flashbacks to Assistive Touch, where that was a feature that was an accessibility feature that then got rolled into a mainline feature for the Apple Watch. And it's got me excited, A, because eye tracking is something that in my area of psychology, we've been paying thousands of dollars for over many years. It'd be nice to be able to do it on a consumer level device. But also, it's kind of a cool idea that it could be activated. Yeah. You know, you could scroll with just your eyes and those sorts of things. So be very curious to see how it looks when it finally comes out. I still argue that some of the best features on iOS in terms of customizing your device are in accessibility. You can find a lot of things in there that many other vendors would charge quite a bit of money for that Apple just quietly rolls in and hardly ever announces, doesn't announce usually at WWDC, announces in the middle of Google I.O., oddly enough, because it's always around Accessibility Day. And so, yeah, that'll be a cool one. But the whole news feature lists a few other ideas. But the eye tracking is what I'm interested in seeing and playing with when we get our hands on the betas.